In this lecture, we shall speak of Professor Damodar Dharmananda Kosambi, generally known as D.D. Kosambi, a man of extraordinary talents and achievements. He was born in a peasant family in Goa, a village called Kesben. His father, Dharmananda's father, that is Dharmananda Kosambi, was basically a man of agriculture. But when he read a book about the Buddha, when he was 16, he had an inclination to find out more about him. And thus, when Dharmananda's father died, he left his village and went to Pune and then to Kashi to learn Sanskrit and Pali, and thereafter became a sound Buddhist scholar. When he was invited to Harvard, USA, to help editing the Pali text called Vishuddhi Magga, Vishuddhi Marga in Sanskrit, he took his son Damodar with him, and he had his schooling and his collegiate education there. So Kosambi never had a chance of knowing India when he was an adolescent. He knew only the USA. But under those circumstances, how he became a Marxist and when he became a Marxist is a mystery. His biographers have not shed any light on this aspect. He was a student of mathematics, a brilliant scholar. He got his AB degree from Harvard, summa cum laude, that is the highest honor to be paid. But without going for PhD, he decided to come back to India. Those were the days of depression, and there was little room for scholarship and grants. And after coming back, he started teaching mathematics, first in Banaras, then in Aligarh, and finally for 12 years in Ferguson College, Pune. This is where he first met Vasudev Vishwanath Gokhale, with whom he had struck up a deep friendship, which culminated in a joint work. They edited the Shubhashita Ratnakosha, a collection of verses of various poets compiled by one Buddhist monk, Vidyakara. But that was a matter long after. When he was teaching in Pune, he was still pursuing his research, although there was little room for it. The college authorities only wanted students to pass and score well. There was no room for research or training up students. In spite of that, Kosambi continued his own work on various aspects of mathematics, on four basic areas, as some scholars have pointed out. It was path geometry, it was statistics, and so many other aspects with which only the specialist, I would rather say super specialist, are aware of. That is how his papers were published in French, in Russian, as also in English. But this was the time when he was working on statistics, and he wanted to find how much his formulae, the formulae he had invented or brought out from his works, pure mathematical treatises, can be applied in practice, or whether they were applicable at all. That is what led him to the search of coins, the history of numismatics, the study of coins in India. From the hoards of coins, he started getting the data he wanted, and ultimately his studies on the hoards became a wonder of the numismaticists. He was by training only a mathematician, but now he has become a welcome guest in the field of numismatics. But this was not all. Kosambi also wanted to find out the temporal relationship, the relationship in time, how the coins came and degenerated, and how new coins were no more coined, and how and why these things happened. He wanted to read the inscriptions and find out the dates of the coins in order to find out which came earlier and which later. This led him to the study of Sanskrit in right earnest, and that is what led him finally to editing a work of 300 verses, three centuries, attributed to Bhartrihari. Nothing is known about this poet Bhartrihari, but hundreds of such verses are current on several areas, utterly unrelated to one another. And that is how Kosambi edited, single-handedly, the three centuries of Bhartrihari's epigrams. For a man who had no previous knowledge of Sanskrit, to venture into a world of, again, super specialists, that is Sanskrit text criticism, is a venture which takes your breath away. Kosambi, of course, had the assistance of such a gigantic scholar as Vishnu Sitaram Sukhtankar, the editor, general editor of the Mahabharata project, who was seeing through the critical edition of the work edited by multiple hands. It was with the blessing, so to say, of Sukhtankar that Kosambi ventured into this work, and the work was finally published by a Jain publisher. This work, he says, brought him to Indology right from the roof. By piercing the roof, he came down to the work of Indology. A rank outsider, a mathematician, and that is what people knew him to be. The son of one Buddhist scholar, himself a mathematician, now turned a text critic. But Kosambi was that sort of person whose hunger was never abated. It grew with eating. And so he ventured into other fields of Indian studies, particularly Indian history, different aspects, culture, civilization, as well as the economic basis. What he wanted most to study was the relationship between the instruments of production and the relations of production between the different classes of society. And this is what led him to the study of history and culminated after a series of essays here and there in a book, An Introduction to the Study of Indian History. First published in 1956, it created quite a sensation to the scholarly world. This was not a book to be read by anybody and everybody. It's a difficult book. Kosambi never knew how to write in a popular style. It was always scholarly. And his language was chiseled, brief and succinct to the point of being obscure. But the book, in spite of so many other defects in printing, in technological problems and others, was a sensation, as I said. It was reviewed in all Indological journals, in Oriental studies, and although people were rather flabbergasted, not just surprised, but flabbergasted by many of his conclusions, they could not ignore the work. And this led him to further works, and here he made Marxism an essential part of his studies. Kosambi was the first man, perhaps, who claimed that Marx's study of India, his comments on India in his early writings, particularly in 1853, the two essays published in the New York Daily Tribune, The British Rule in India and The Future of the British Rule in India, do not represent a true picture of ancient India. He pointed out that our traditional view of India has been reflected in Marx's opinion also, but the traditional view is wrong. India also underwent several changes in the course of her development, and the unchanging nature of Indian society, which Marx insisted on, is a myth. There have always been changes, and such changes have to be noticed and accounted for. In spite of making such scathing criticism of Marx's view of India, Kosambi asserted that in spite of all this, my method remains Marxist, as I understand it. As I understand it is a statement to be remembered. His understanding of Marxism was always non-doctrinaire, totally unconventional. He felt that it was just a method, not a system, and it was not to be studied for the purpose of knowing only, but also to be employed as a tool of analysis. He felt that in 1853, Marx had not done that, and that is what Kosambi started doing. Kosambi's basic area was, of course, ancient India. Although the book, this introduction, covers the whole of India and throughout the ages, from the Pathan Mughals down to the British, those parts are rather fragmentary. These are one of the points of criticism made by others, that almost the whole of the work is concerned with ancient India. But Kosambi does not mention that either in the title or in the preface. This, what you may call a drawback, was redressed in the second book he wrote. It was The Culture and Civilization of Ancient India in Historical Outline. Here he did not go beyond the 12th century. He ended with Jayadeva, the Sanskrit poet, the period where the Middle Ages starts. And this is how this book also created a sensation. Some complained that there was no footnotes, but that is what Kosambi meant to be, a book without footnotes, which would state the facts clearly and positively. It was commissioned by the Cuban government for their encyclopedia, but due to various reasons, the encyclopedia project did not materialize, and Kosambi had it published as a separate book, first in England and then in India. The book, as I said, created a sensation because Kosambi paid so much attention to ploughs. He printed two pictures of two ploughs, one of the Kushana age and one of the modern age, showing that the instruments of production did not undergo a sea change. The same kind of plough was used by the Kushanas at Kushana's times, as also in modern times. And there were pictures of both artworks as well as common man's life. The life of the weaver, the life of the peasant, the kind of enjoyments, entertainments that people have in their lives. The photographs of Sunil Yana are, of course, a pleasure to see. But altogether, it was a very wide view of India. Ancient India, to be sure, but ancient India as it can be viewed even from the modern times. Apart from these two books on history, Kosambi attempted another work of editing, an anthology of poems, stray poems attributed not to one poet but to many. As I said before, it is the Subhashita Ratnakosha, the jeweled collection of moral verses or good verses, Subhashita. These verses were first found in an anthology, but the editing leaves much to be desired. So Kosambi wanted first to get more manuscripts. The problem here was of the opposite kind that he faced in editing Bhartrihari. With Bhartrihari, there was no paucity of manuscripts. Hundreds of manuscripts here and there, but mostly of no value. Here, there was no second manuscript even. Rahul Shankarachan had bought photographs from Tibet, but they did not prove to be useful. So with Tucci's photographs. They too were taken under such circumstances that did not permit good, legible reading. Then Kosambi was so desperate that he wrote to Jawaharlal Nehru to get a copy from Nepal. He had already tried it through the Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute. The curator had written to the curator there for a copy, but no response was made. So Kosambi, as a last resort, appealed to the Prime Minister of India, who was kind enough to forward it to his office, who in their turn wrote to the Indian embassy in Kathmandu, and this is how another copy of the manuscript was obtained. So on the basis of these very few materials, Kosambi started editing the work, here with the collaboration of Vasudev Vishwanath Gokhale, an old friend as I said, and the book came out in the Harvard Oriental series in 1957. The book, apart from its value as a Sanskrit work of anthology, is more valuable because of the introduction that Kosambi had written all alone. This is Kosambi's own work, not to be shared by Gokhale or anyone else. This introduction shows Kosambi's attitude towards Sanskrit literature as a whole, his view of the poets, their conditions, how they lived, and what made them write such verses, and how the poets are to be understood against the backdrop of their society, the stage of their society they lived in. Scholarly world accepted the world with some pinch of salt. They liked the editing, true, but as regards the introduction, their attitude was ambivalent, mostly negative. Instead of praising all the poets and all the works, Kosambi rather exposed the Brahminical society which made certain works possible and certain works all to be excluded. Kosambi drew attention to the section of poems called Jati Vraja, where common man's life, the minutes of their life, are shown. This is not the exactly most important part of Sanskrit poetry as known by the Sanskrit students, but Kosambi's study and at the same time comments on these verses opened up a new field of research and understanding. And that's how the book continues to be used by both scholars and historians. Historians not only of Sanskrit literature, but also of society as a whole. Apart from these books, the edited works, Kosambi had written nearly 100, the number may be a little more or a little less, essays, papers and articles on different aspects of Indian society, history, archaeology and literature. This is where Kosambi's achievement shines bright. Fortunately, Brajadulal Chattopadhyay of Bengal has collected his uncollected essays from obscure journals and rare anthologies. And out of these, he had produced Kosambi's essays on Indology. Together, they constitute a kind of treasure trove where Marxists and non-Marxists can find many areas of interest which can be explored further. The essays, like Kosambi's other works, are both incisive and exhaustive. He could look into the heart of the matter and bring out the essence of it. The definition of history, as he had given, the account of the instruments of production, means of production, and the relations of productions in chronological order. That is how he had always approached history, and all Marxists, whether in India or elsewhere, should follow this definition as a kind of guide. Kosambi didn't write much in that sense, but that will be a totally wrong statement. Side by side with his works on Indology, he had also written papers on mathematics, on different branches of mathematics, on path geometry, on statistics, and so many other obscure areas close to the lay readers. The papers on numismatics have been collected, but it's high time some people should also take initiative to publish his scientific papers. That would show how Kosambi could always defy the claims for specialization. To him, knowledge was one and indivisible. whether it was of the humanities or of the sciences. And that's how Kosambi stands as a living protest against the theory of two cultures, of the scientific culture and the culture of the humanities. Such a man is rare in any country, but mostly in India. And the task of the Marxists in India is to continue his work in the right spirit and with devotion to details, as he had taught us to be.